So we have a good evening, everybody. Welcome to a very special session and a very special webinar with Ramdev ji and Naveen. Basically, a lot of these webinars we are having in these trying times that we are all going through to educate people, to enlighten people in the best possible way we can regarding how to take things forward and how to navigate these tough times. One name which comes to our mind is Warren Buffett, the legendary investor who is now approaching his 90s, or actually already in his 90s. And he has this every year, the Woodstock for Capitalists event in Omaha in Nebraska, which is basically the annual Berkshire Hathaway, the holding company that he runs, his annual general meeting. And a lot of people, a lot of these smart individuals across the world look forward to what the sage of Omaha, as he's fondly called, has to say. Okay. Now, Ramdev ji has been avidly following Warren Buffett in spirit and in actually physically also. And I think last 25 years, he may have missed around only one or two meetings and attended 22, 23 meetings of the sage in Omaha. It's not only about attending, it's a pilgrimage of sorts for investment, where people go and listen to what he has to say, listen to what he has done, and listen to his pithy sayings, which hold a lot of relevance even today. This year, again, it was a very special kind of event because the stadium was empty, the entire conference room was totally empty, and Charlie Munger, his longtime trusted partner, also was not next to him. I've also had the privilege of attending this Berkshire Hathaway conference in Omaha, and I can tell you that it's one of the most exhilarating events to attend, and seeing the electric atmosphere out there and seeing the kind of companies that Warren Buffett has created or invested in or made is truly one of a kind. Ramdev ji follows Buffett, and Ramdev ji also tries to imbibe the philosophy of Buffett in whatever Motilal Oswal as a firm does. It's very deeply ingrained in our investment philosophy. So without much ado, we will ask Ramdev ji to take center stage and explain his take on the massive cash hoard that Buffett holds right now. Why he's not invested, gone, you know, the fear is very, he's very well known for investing when there's fear in the market. Why he's not gone ahead and invested too much. A lot of other things which came out from this AGM. We will not have any question answers right now. We will wait for Ramdev ji to end. Should be around 30 minutes. Then Naveen will give his view on our how we can translate or we can, you know, kind of implement the learnings from Omaha into India. Okay, are there any learnings to implement? If so, then how we can implement it? So without much ado, Ramdev ji, over to you.
Good evening, friends. Pleasure to talking to all of you, and particularly about Buffett learnings. You know, it's slightly now, what, it's almost 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 2nd of May it happened. So the markets have been a very different mood. I would say, even Buffett was a disconnect to what's happening in the markets now, post the event also. So, you know, one of the things is that he was alone, and Charlie Munger was not there. And I think most importantly, all those 45,000 people who are always there in the audience, they were not there. So he used to enjoy walking through shopping arena, talking to people, shaking hands, and generally he was giggling and, you know, absolutely buoyant mood. But on second, he was a little more thoughtful, and since people were not around, probably he was a little more, you know, but I think he had set his mind, and since he was knowing that he's going to make a digital presentation from the podium, rather than talking to people straight. So he had prepared slides, I mean, very unusual. And he went, so it is the best exposition, I would say, of his learnings and experience and the way he puts things. So he was at his best, and so I would request everybody, to those who like to learn from him, I think they must listen to him on video, and even better is to find the script of what he said, the proceedings of 2020 AGM. There, I think I have a copy which is about 42 pages, but I saw another script which was about 62 pages in Google. So I think going through all of them, you'll find a lot of nuggets within those utterances, and that's really nice to go through. So I have gone through the entire script as well as I have listened to it. So actually, it is the fun of attending him and listening to him is that there is you're not surprised by what he says on various issues. So he's very consistent, and he's consistent right from 65, 67. If you see his earlier writings, I don't know. I mean, I have seen very little improvement, very little change in what he says on a particular subject. So if you ask any question, he will be very patient. Every year he'll repeat the answer, but the answer will be same. So that's the beauty of this thing. He has thought through. I mean, most of the thing he has thought through. Only one or two things comes new through the year. So he's very matured in his thinking on investing principles, and the way he wants to go about it, and the way he looks at the world. So you know, he started this AGM with a presentation on history of America. I think he presented on 281 years of American history. I mean, pre-independence, you know, and what kind of a primitiveness it was there. And there was a civil riots, and some millions of people died. And so basically, he was praising the glory of America. Against every odd, America has gotten up and moved ahead. So don't bet against America. In the long run, today America might be down, or American economy might be suffering. But he has seen that against every odd, whether it is a global financial crisis, whether it is 9/11, or the civil riots of the past, or even the 1929 depression, America has kind of moved on. So the long-term backdrop he gave was that of positivity, because he was coming back to uncertain near-term. And so how does he think about near-term or mid-term, this 1, 2, 3 years? So there he was kind of a very uncertain. He's saying that this is the biggest unknown. So neither he's saying it is pessimistic. Obviously, he's not saying that this is bullish, but he's saying that nobody knows what is going to happen. And he has not seen anything like this in his, 70, 80 years of investing history. He's 90 now, and he was born in 1930. And he started buying at the age of 11, 1941. So he has seen almost 77, 78 years of investing career. Amazing. I mean, when you say this number, that itself is so crazy. 78 years non-stop, every day he's coming, I mean, he's watching the market. So, and Berkshire Hathaway is the largest net worth company in the world. It is not the largest market cap company, but this is the largest net worth company. $370 billion is the net worth of the company, and market cap is around $450, $460 billion as we talk. So, it is the largest. I didn't realize till this event happened that it is the largest net worth company. So Microsoft and there are other companies, but they're not, their net worth is not that big. So because he has not paid dividend also. I mean, in his lifetime, he has never given dividend. So all the earnings he has done since he has taken over in 60s, it's all amassed there. So don't bet against America. That was his big theme. Then he's talking about his experiences. I mean, few very bad things happened in the economy in the past. And one of them was clearly 1929, 30. I mean, that stuck to my mind when he was he was talking about that the stress on that particular event was very high. There he is saying that the markets were booming clearly before 29, and market went up to about 350, and from there market slumped to 200. So there was a big decline of about maybe 30-35%, and then market pulled back from 200 to 250, 260. People thought that it is done and dusted, and we are through the whatever problem they had. And then in next 2 years, markets went down from 250 to 42.11. That was the, it took 2 years from there. This was in 1929, and in 1932, market hit the bottom. He had taken out every single date and the bottoms. It was 42.11. So he had done his research, and he was very clear that that is also one of the possibilities. Like, it was so bad, and it took 20 years. I think in 1952, the market crossed the 350 from where it had started declining. So that is the nature of the market. You don't know, and we are into biggest unknown. This is already US has lost more than 20 million jobs, 20-30 million jobs, and they are doing unprecedented amount of stimulus in monetary and financials, and they're willing to do even more. So clearly the size of the stimulus itself tells that the problem is very, very big. So his view is very clear that let's not try to bet one way or other. He's not saying that it is world is coming to an end, everything will get over, but he doesn't want to speculate which way the outcome is going to be, because it is the biggest unknown, he's saying. And then came the thing about his cash balance of $135 billion. There he's saying that probably he needs to maybe it is not sufficient to take care of the current crisis, because one has to understand the nature of his business. He's the biggest insurer in the world. He must be having 20 trillions or maybe $25 trillion worth of risk underwritten under him. And this is extremely unknown kind of a situation, for which in many insurance contracts, he might have not even thought that this kind of thing can happen. Like oil can trade negative or something, you know. The lot of claims can come simultaneously. Right now, the claims are not there, but you never know. In next 30 days, 60 days, a lot of things can converge and create big claim on the policies. So he doesn't want to be out of money as far as whenever the claim comes. So he's saying that since we don't know what is going to happen, I would rather sit on my cash. And actually, I would stress that we should have more of this. And actually, I saw that he had borrowed, he had floated some bonds in Europe and Japan at zero interest rate. So actually, he's sitting right now, he must have amassed another $4-5 billion since the meeting itself. So clearly, he's making sure that the cash holds with him is a lot more till this uncertainty is over. So clearly, this is not the time to go and buy. And so what he's saying is that even what you buy, you must understand what you're doing. And there comes that his investment in airlines. So in airlines, he invested, I think, $6 or $7 billion, and he bought into 10% of all the four airlines. First, he badmouthed for 20 years that it is the worst business in the world, airline businesses. And then he went and bought 10% limit up in all the four airlines. And he was doing reasonably well before this COVID hit. And then he cleaned up all 10% of all the four companies at a loss. So basically, he's saying that there are going to be a lot of planes, unused planes, for many years to come. And hence, we don't want to be party to whatever is the... This is very unusual of him. Typically, earlier, he we used to be buy right, sit tight, or buy forever types of situation. In last 2-3 years, because of his underperformance and maybe suffering from a few other investments, I think they have decided to, when the fundamentals change, we'll also relook at the situation. So he has kind of brought some kind of a selling policy. But here he is saying that we have cleaned up what we don't understand. We have cleaned up everything. He has not taken a bet of 50, let's sell 50% or 80%. He has, what he doesn't understand, he said, let me just get out completely. And so basically it comes to understanding what you are doing in the market is very important. Very, very, very important. Even earlier in 2007 annual report, he had said, in investing, there are only 4 things required. First, what you understand. Second, terrific economics. Third, terrific management. And fourth, is the sensible management. So he had, even in 2007, he had said that understanding is very important. And today he used the same framework to say, let me get out of airlines, because now I can't see what is going to happen in next 5, 10, 15 years to these airlines, because there are going to be too many additional planes lying on the ground. So he decided to get out, and he said, the insight in this entire thing is that
just trying to fix up. I think the video is frozen somewhere. Yeah. Yeah, continue.
So, we got disconnected. So, he's saying that what is important is to have a terrific strike rate. And if the good businesses to start with becomes bad, it can happen to anybody. But how good is the strike rate? So when you buy 10 stocks in next 10 years, out of that, one or two go bad, like the airline investment for him has gone bad. It is better to clean it up completely and then move on to the next one and again buy a good stock. So what is important is I used to always repent that I committed this mistake or that mistake, but that is going to happen. You always think that your framework is right, that you are buying quality and later on it doesn't turn out to be quality, or you are buying quality and growth and later on it turns out to be it is low quality and actually even low growth. So that's all, it's all in the warm-up future. What is important is your process has to be right and you must adhere to a very high quality process. That's what was my learning. And about the current current situation in the marketplace, he's saying that, I think his own off-repeated this thing, saying that when there is a fear on the street, you should be greedy. And I think the world has already become very greedy. There was a fear at point of time. And investors, they came back with vengeance and the market has corrected back. So he's saying that there is not enough fear and valuations have corrected. It went down, but it didn't further go down. And to a level where it's not raining gold. He used the word, it's not raining gold. His phone is not ringing. In 2008, now this is drawing 2008. In 2008, the collapse was so total and it remained, it kept on kind of that entire thing. it lasted for 13, 14 months before it hit the bottom. So in the, after the vertical collapse in next 2-3 months, there was no pickup so quickly the way it happened here. And things started becoming quite messy. And since it was all financial, Bear Stearns and all these big banks, Merrill Lynch and all, they had deep problem. So much so that Goldman Sachs, most, Gold Standard, they also had problem, and they came to them and they borrowed that $5 billion at some crazy, crazy price. So he's saying that nobody's looking for money, because what happened was that, yes, there was a crisis and crisis was building up, but Fed responded. What they didn't do, what Fed didn't do in 2008, they did this time. And they, the second or third day, they came with a full bazooka of 10% GDP in terms of liquidity and 10% GDP in terms of fiscal incentive. So the corporates and mid corporates or large corporates, those who are looking for money, they got all the support from the government side. So they didn't have to go to the private financial like Buffett. And hence, they didn't get any, they didn't get a deep buyer's market. It remained a kind of, for some few days, there was some deep fear, but again, it corrected. And now, I think the indices in US has come back to, I think, less than 10% kind of. Nasdaq is 5-6% away from the top. And other Dow is just about 12-15% kind of away from the all-time high. So clearly, it has not given them the kind of opportunity probably he was waiting for. I mean, one of the reason he has not invested in his cash, while he was saying that S&P by default, that you should invest in S&P 500 if you don't know the game of the stock market selection. And he himself didn't invest in a stock market and stayed in the cash for a very, very long time. And that is one of the major reason for his underperformance in last 10, 15 years. Because the value of cash, which used to be 5-6% earlier, has started yielding just about a percentage or two. And so actually his hard-earned float by Ajit is of not much value, because that was a major source of his outperformance vis-a-vis entire indices. So they have remained very cautious even now. And since the phone is not ringing, so basically there are not enough panic on the street. They are saying that it's not running gold. Yeah, another thing he was saying was the fear is more contagious than even COVID. What happens is that once market collapses, and economic collapses, then the mindset of the people, that changes. In fact, the Great Depression lasted much more in the minds of the people in 1929, 1930. It was so deep and so scathing, and monetary policy and government help was so limited. Even the knowledge of how to handle the economy was very low. So it became very, very bad, and the unemployment levels reached some crazy levels, and people really suffered. So that those bad periods stayed in the minds of the people. So people became very, very risk averse. And so coming out of that required almost 20 years of 20 years of life from 1929-30 to 1950. You can imagine, it's like what we are witnessing right now about the Japan. I mean, Japan made top in, I think, 1990 or sometime. And still, I mean, they're not back to that level. So these things have, this is what is his experience. And he's trying to remember all these things at this point of time. And he's saying that that $135 billion, one of the reasons he's not spending is that if these claims comes or some exigencies come, he doesn't want to depend, though he can call up anybody and get some money, but he's saying that he doesn't want to depend neither on friends nor on the strangers. So he's saying that I must conduct myself in such a way that in worst of the situation, he's preparing for the worst. Probably worst may never happen, and nobody wishes that worst will happen. But he's preparing for the worst, and in that situation also, he doesn't have to go to the Fed or anybody. to get $25-30 billion to take care of any claim and all. So he is very clear that so that's why he, another reason, in this kind of risky situation, he doesn't want to. So even at my level, I mean, this made me really think that we must conduct ourselves in such a way that we pass through this storm. We should not try to make some speculative bet here. And obviously, if you make a speculative bet, in some cases you'll be positive, in some cases you'll be negative. But this is by chance, if the things turn against you and you become negative and you are not able to pass through properly, the people who are going, look at the today, whatever is happening by the government, they are trying to save good guys. There is no help to the bad guys. So, the bad guys mean the financially who are constrained before COVID, they are getting no support. The only the guys who are in good shape, they are only getting good support from the government. Even that is, whether it is sufficient or not, only time will tell. But clearly, it will be very unfortunate if anybody gets caught in this storm. So these were the things which were a part of his speech, which I could remember. And apart from in Q&A, there were some more instances of the history, but this is what in his main presentation he was talking about. But let me tell you, his macro calls, I remember in 2008 also, his macro calls are not great. I mean, he is very fearful. But in 2008, on the eve of, in 2007, he was asked this question. I distinctly remember, I've heard it myself, when he was asked, what do you think of the mortgage delinquencies which were building up in the system? He said, there is no problem. Whatever extra houses are there, because job market is very buoyant, all those will be absorbed and we'll pass over it. I don't think there is any problem. And you saw in next 1 year, the whole world economy, including America, it just collapsed. So maybe that time he was a bit more optimistic than today. He could. But, this macro calls are crazy thing. One should not bother too much about the macro call, what he's saying, the fear, to be fearful too much about. But that's what he was. I think the real message is not about his call on the economy or the markets and things like that. The real message is that you got to be careful. This is a storm. This is the biggest unknown, and you should be very careful while this storm is passing through. So that's the message I'm getting, and so one has to be careful. And hence, even in Indian markets, when we go to buy, I would suggest that you got to be very careful in what you're buying. And doing it yourself is a lot of fun in the markets, and everybody would aspire to be a terrific stock picker. But this is not the time to start learning to pick stocks, because you require a lot of skill. And if you are the old master of picking stocks, of course, this is the most interesting time to pick stocks. But if you are not such a the old hand, in that case, you must come to the market, but you must come with some assistance from PMS managers or some friend who is managing, or asset manager, because the opportunities are emerging. But finding those opportunities, they look simple, but they're not that simple. That's not so easy. So to construct a very good, diversified, well-balanced portfolio, I think it requires a lot. And beating the indices is very tough. Now even Buffett is finding it difficult for last 10 years, 12 years to beat the index with his style. So obviously what has happened is that he himself has created competition for himself, and there are too many followers of him, and all the young kids, they are able to use his strategies and kind of become a smart.
I think the Ramdevji screen is frozen again.
Do you want me to start and at the fag end of his presentation?
Naveen, do you want to start?
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Naveen, can you present Ramdevji? Yeah. I think he's come again. Yeah, he's come. Ramdevji, yes. Are there?
So I'm almost done. So I was talking about. One should not bet against India also, but now you can bet in America, sitting in India, through Nasdaq ETF, through S&P 500 ETF, bought in rupee. So lots of possibilities are there. And I would think that Indian story is also very compelling. And we have thrived in this market. It's a very, India being emerging market, there are a lot of challenges. I mean, in 92, we saw the literally bankruptcy of India in the global money market. And we had to send gold to get some $60 million line. Today, every deal of Reliance is more than $1 billion. So, I mean, just see the change of times. I mean, collecting a lakh crore, he has made a joke out of it. So, I think this is when you see 20, 30 years, ahead, you cannot do the compounding and what can be the size change. I mean, even in the head, it doesn't go. What it will be, say, 20 years from here, the economy, the country, and what is the possibility for individual companies. So those are the very exciting thoughts and possibilities. I have seen in front of me, HDFC Bank opening the doors and public issue happening at 40 rupees and at 800 crores, you could buy the entire bank. 800 crores and see what it is today. It is a few thousand times. Infosys happened. Nobody wanted to look at them in 94, 95 at 100 crores market cap. Today, I think it is up some 8,000-10,000 times. So this is a country of opportunities and we also must not bet against India finally and build a nice portfolio of good companies and have a nice, safe and secured future for your wealth. So we'll take questions. And I think before that, Naveen will supplement with whatever he has picked up out of this speech.
So, sir, Ramdevji, thank you very much for a very enlightening session. We'll ask Naveen to speak a few words, especially relevant from Indian perspective, what it means for India, for us, for the investors. And then once Naveen is done with his discussion, then we will open the chat for questions. Over to you, Naveen.
Hi, good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to host all of you for this webinar on our favorite subject, which is about Warren Buffett and about Berkshire Hathaway and their annual AGM. Berkshire Hathaway AGMs are always fantastic source of learning for anybody who's practicing investments. And we have been followers of Buffett now for several decades. And if you see the AGM for the last several years, usually there is a lot of insight centered around investing and businesses, right? Because Buffett thinks that investing and businesses join at the hip. But this time around, the history lessons that Buffett took us through and the kind of effort in terms of analysis and research that he did is something that I think will remain relevant for us, relevant for investing and relevant for history books also, because some of the math that he produced and presented is something that at least was news to all of us. So what I'm going to do is I have a few points that I took away from the AGM and what is the context of all of those points for India is what I'll quickly run through. Ramdevji has already covered, I think, the entire AGM very well and extensively. So the first is that you know, the history lessons tell us that nations go through really challenging times, right? And all hope by the best of the brains is lost, you know, when we go through these challenges. And, you know, nations emerge from all of these challenges, from all the crises. So basically, he goes on to, you know, tell us that US was born in 1789. And, you know, 72 years after they were born, there was a civil war which went on from 1861 to 1865. So, you know, somewhere in the middle of that war, the then president of the US made a statement that, you know, this is a really testing times, and this is a true test of whether this nation will endure, you know, whether it will survive. It was conceived with so much dedication and so much effort, you know, throwing the Britishers out of United States after so many battles and war. But you know, will they be able to endure this, you know, civil war? And I mean, again, this is something which is unique. He goes on to say that a huge part of the entire, you know, working population got wiped off, was killed in the civil war, almost 6%. And so what is the relevance of, you know, US was born, you know, 74 years later, there was the statement that whether they will survive by the then president. You know, basically the relevance is that, you know, US could endure 4 years of civil war, which, you know, killed 6% of their working population. And today we have COVID, where there are 350,000 deaths all over the world, not United States, but an entire world. There's 350,000 deaths, which is a hell of a lot. But will the world endure this? Most certainly. And likewise, relevance for India is that, you know, if 76 years later, when the civil war got over, US could come back to become the greatest nation in the world. You know, our country, we got independence from the same Britishers, you know, 73 years back. So there are so many dark clouds, so many doubts, you know, about India all the time that we have. You know, Indian markets have not performed. We've done so badly. We have underperformed even emerging markets over the last 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 3 years, 5 years. You know, we've underperformed the developed markets by a huge margin. We have the lowest stimulus in the world to offer. Will we be able to come out of this problem? So there are all these kind of dark clouds, all these doubts, but the world has endured far bigger challenges. The US has endured far bigger challenges. And, you know, from those challenges, the nations emerge. In fact, you know, some time ago, we learned that most financials, most lenders, most banks emerge out of a credit crisis through growth. And likewise, most nations emerge out of insurmountable and huge quantum of debt through the growth in the GDP. So, you know, even post-World War, the debt of the world was the highest, and nobody talked about debt after, just immediately after the World War, everybody was worried about debt. All the economists were worried about debt, and that became a non-issue 5, 10, 15 years later. In fact, the golden era was ahead. So even out of this crisis, you will see, you know, the world growing out of it. And right now we'll be at the abyss in terms of bottom, in terms of, you know, fear, in terms of, you know, risk aversion and so on. Yeah. The second point that he goes on to mention is that, you know, that US is remarkably young at the age of 231. So US is 230 years old, and he thinks that they are remarkably young at this age, and we are, you know, 73 years old. So the runway for India really seems to be really very, very long, given the favorable demographics. And mind you, you know, US suggested that all men should be equal. And after their, you know, independence, they found that 15% of the population was slaves. You know, US wanted everybody to be equal, so women to have equal rights. And women there got voting rights after 130 years, and women joined the Supreme Court there after 190 years. So basically, what I'm only trying to say is that, you know, you have all these doubts, you know, that things are not working out, policies are not working out, politicians are saying something, but in reality, life is so different. But, you know, these things don't matter really from the, you know, very long term. Now, the third thing that I took away from the AGM was don't bet against America. And this is where Buffett presented some really fantastic numbers and insights. He mentioned that as per his estimate, and he's the best guy to make that estimate, he said that he estimates that, you know, at the point of independence, the wildest guess of Buffett is that the total wealth of the United States is about $1 billion. And the estimated wealth of the United States in 2020, if you put up, you know, real estate, if you include equities, you include fixed everything, basically, that works out to about $100 trillion. So the $1 billion have gone up by 100,000 times, 100,000 times to $100 trillion. And I'm sure all of you are aware that real estate and fixed income and all of those have not multiplied 100,000 times. So basically, equity markets that have multiplied a lot more than, you know, 100,000 times. And how much has Sensex multiplied? You know, so Sensex was born in 1979, and Sensex is up 300 times in nominal terms now. And, you know, so the runway ahead, you know, for all of us is really long. We have several positives like, you know, demographics. We have several positives like potential, you know, large sourcing from India now that the world is actively seeking an alternative to China. And there are like dozens and dozens, and maybe a few hundred companies that are already negotiating with the Indian government to set up manufacturing facilities here. So I think, like Buffett said, don't bet against America. I would think that the same applies to India. Basically, don't bet against India as well. The next point that I, you know, really found remarkable was how Buffett, you know, admitted his mistake in airlines and, you know, really sold all of them. I think only a professional investor and one who has skin in the game like Warren Buffett or like Ramdev Agarwal can swallow the ego, admit the mistake, and change the mind when facts change. So basically, they worry only about doing the right things. They don't worry about how stupid they may appear if they do that thing. So I feel very few individual investors will be able to walk out of their mistakes as easily, as quickly, once they realize that things are wrong. And I think most professional investors too will get bogged down by how it appears rather than whether it is the right thing to do. And that is something that is unique about some of these investors. The next point that I took away was that, you know, sometimes these falls can be really retrenching. And again, I'm rounding off numbers, but he mentioned that, you know, Dow Jones, which was at 400 level before the depression, fell in the first round to 200, right? By 50%. Then rose by 25%, nearly 25% to 250 points, from 400 to 200 and then to 250. And from there, it went on to make a low of 40 points, which is down by 85% from the lower level. So from 250 all the way down to 40. So basically, he goes on to give these details and then he adds that, you know, do you remember that, you know, markets were down 22% in a single day in 1987, October. He goes on to add that markets were actually shut for 4 months in 1914. And then they were shut for 4 days in, you know, post 9/11. And that the markets fell so much after falling post-depression. So basically, when he's saying all this, and then he goes on to add that, you know, you can't be too sure about yourself. And he goes on to say that at some stage, virus will come back and that the virus will decide our response over the next 12 to 18 months. Basically, he has access to the world's best brains, whether it's Bill Gates, whether it's Sam Nunn, whether it is Fauci, all of these guys, he directly picks up the phone and talks to. So basically, he's saying that while, you know, don't bet against America, but he goes on to add that you guys have to be very careful about how you bet. Simply because markets can do anything, you know, in the short term, like he gave all these 3-4 examples. So as a rain check, you know, he's got $137 billion of cash. He's actually borrowed money to add to that, you know, liquidity pile. He's actually sold in the current year. He sold airlines, but he sold other stuff as well. Most recently, he got out of his Goldman Sachs position also. Buffett chose not to buy Berkshire despite Berkshire falling from $350,000 to $240,000 because he thinks that the value in Berkshire itself is still not emerged despite a 30% fall. So as Ramdevji said, he's not backing up the truck and he's gone wrong on macro call. So it's for you to see whether you want to really, you know, listen to him or follow him or, but basically, he sounded, you know, reasonably, you know, cautious while, you know, highlighting or reiterating how bullish, you know, one should be in the longer term and that one should not bet against America. Yeah, so those are just a few thoughts and how, you know, one can relate them to India. Back to you, Naveen.
Okay, thank you, Naveen. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ramdevji. We've had some nice questions. So I've cherry-picked five or six of them, which are relevant for us to understand. And it's addressed to both Ramdevji and Naveen, so they can take their choice in answering them. The first question, Ramdevji, since you've been such a big follower of Buffett over the last 20, 30 years, in my mind, I don't think anybody has followed him so staunchly and so avidly as you have done. To the extent that we as who work, who associated with the company, feel, you know, Buffett in our own building, okay, sometimes. Okay. So, Ramdevji, what is the single biggest learning that you have learned from Buffett over these years? If there's one thing that crystallizes Buffett, what is it? Ramdevji, aapko mute hai.
So, for me, truly, he is a guru. And actually, sometime back, he was asked, what would you like to be known for? You know, so he said, the best teacher in the world. So, he is the best teacher. And I couldn't get anyone better than him. And actually, if you go through his annual reports, it's not only me. I think there are a whole lot of guys who have learned from him. And many people have become billionaires and they launched their career and they built entire empire from the learnings of Buffett. So, you know, I mean, he has been really towering personality in my life of investing. Because I used to think I started my career in after 83. After I passed out from chartered accountancy. So I was fanatic about the stock market. But you know, that energy also needs some kind of streamlining. Like if you want to learn accounting, you have to do CA. The moment you go to CA, they streamline you completely how to look at the books of a company. Otherwise, whatever resources you have, if you don't learn the, if you don't become chartered accountant, you are not complete. You don't know how exactly to look at various aspects of corporate. So you know, this investing is even crazier. There are aspects of company learning and there is aspects of how the markets behave. So I think step by step, brick by brick, I think the biggest learning is what is a good business and what is a good management. You know, that 4-point framework is the biggest learning, that the first thing is don't do in a stock market or anywhere in the world, any aspect of investing or in life. Don't do anything what you don't understand. Aapki samajh aapki sabse badi asset hai. Aap kitne bade buddhu ho, kitne hoshyar ho, wo jo ho. Matlab, that cannot be changed. And that will determine your own you know, kind of competence. So first thing is bet on your own understanding. And never do anything what you don't understand in any important walk of life. Second, in investing, try to buy terrific businesses. And third, buy terrific management company. I mean, the management team. And fourth is sensible price. And that is what exactly is the QGLP. I mean, Q for quality of business and quality of management. G, which we have put it by way of another explicit number, which in any case, he also sees that quality, growth, longevity of quality and growth, and at a reasonable price. So this is what I have learned, and this is what I have tried to put in a capsule as my formula. But actually, it's Buffett formula. This is my understanding of Buffett formula, actually. So, and it works very well. Even I get confused, I also go to test against any idea where exactly we went wrong. And we find that we went wrong in one of the five, I would say, quality of business, quality of management, growth, longevity, and purchase price. If all five are there, it is impossible you will not make a multi-bagger. Forget about making money, you will make multi-bagging. The issue is, do we have patience to really go through one by one, brick by brick? And it doesn't take much time. I mean, the moment you understand the business, all the five components you can do only if you have the first component, that is whether you understand. The moment you understand the business, then going through those five components will not take even 5 minutes. So if you follow that practice, it will keep you. So that's what has been my biggest learning from him. And this year's biggest learning has been that you can go wrong. Good business can become bad after you bought. But what is important is not you're right or wrong. What is your strike rate? I mean, if in last 10 years you bought 10 companies and out of the 10, 8 are bad and 2 are good, then your strike rate is very bad. So what is important is to, you will commit mistakes. I mean, it's almost certain that in investing, nobody is invincible. Everybody will commit mistakes and come back and see your strike rate and try to improve your strike rate. So these are a few things I learned. So, and actually this is the core of the way we invest. And that's what we tell people how we do it. And every manager is also expected to follow broadly these guidelines.
That's great, Ramdevi. Thank you. Another very interesting question is that, we have these multiple fads in investing in different times. So you have growth investing, you have momentum investing, you have, chasing a trend. Okay. And value investing, which obviously you are a very big proponent of. You think, is value investing a thing of the past or the future?
See, actually, every investing is value investing. But you investing, what is investing? Investing, whether you go to buy a cow, whether you go to buy a land, whether you go and buy a house, you are trying to buy, you as a buyer, you are trying to hit a good deal. आपको लगता है कि कोई चीज का कीमत 10 रुपए है आपको 5 रुपए में खरीदने का 6 रुपए में खरीदने का दैट इज व्हाट इज इन्वेस्टिंग सो दैट इज व्हेन यू पे द प्राइस प्राइस हैज टू बी लोअर देन वैल्यू असेस्ड बाय यू नाउ द इशू इज दैट इन स्टॉक मार्केट असेसिंग वैल्यू इज अ जॉब आई मीन दैट रिक्वायर्स लिटिल स्किल एंड पीपल एज समबडी सेड that in the stock market, 100% of the people know the prices of everything. But very few, you will be surprised how many people understand the underlying value. So investing is all about, it's all about buying 10 rupee thing for, less than 10 rupees. So clearly, value is thing, so long as investing is there, there is no end of, there is no end of value investing. How you practice value investing, that is a big challenge. How do you define? So those earlier fuddy-daddy, low price to book, high dividend yield, zero growth, that kind of investing could be out of fashion. But that's not our style. See, within value also, there are ways of looking at, I would say every manager who is buying stocks and holding it, not speculating, is a value manager. The issue is whether he's good or not. Only time will tell. So I would think that value investing is the only way of investing. And all my competition and myself and everybody is doing value investing so long as they're not speculating. And what is the brand of value investing? How do they understand value investing? That's a different matter.
Naveen, a question to you. The US debt is at an all-time high right now. The Fed is printing money like crazy, right? Even if you have look at US, you look at Japan, yesterday they had this $1.1 trillion kind of stimulus. All these countries are going ahead and printing money. How will this affect their economies and our economy? Okay. And are we entering a hyperinflation kind of situation?
So, as Ramduji mentioned earlier, taking macro calls is always, fraught with a lot of dangers when you are a bottom-up equity investor. But what was a remarkable learning was that, if there is a bank which has amassed a lot of bad loans, it has huge credit problems, right? Then the only way that the bank can come out of it is by growing the balance sheet. And ICICI Bank, which had a lot of problems, we've seen how they have managed it over the last several years. Likewise, whenever there's a crisis in the world, in any part of the world, right? Like the World War II was one of the biggest crises of the century, right? And at that time, the debt to GDP of the world and the absolute debt was just simply unbearable. And most economists said that this is going to cause hyperinflation and this is the end of the world and the world will take a very long time to recover. But the growth in the following decade, you know, really made that entire discussion completely irrelevant. So I think really the question is, the only way to grow out of a, you know, credit problem for a lender and the only way to grow out of debt problem for an economy is the growth of you know, the balance sheet for a lender and the growth of GDP for a country. And I think that is a panacea, and most people underestimate how long term, you know, this same debt will start looking quite irrelevant. So I have no expertise on, you know, whether that is going to be repeated this time. That is going to be the case with the US, whether US will have GDP growth or not. I have no, but I'm saying that all historical examples of countries with potential to grow or potential to come back have come out of this problem. So GFC, when there was huge debt, US and all the US financials came out of that problem. And I think most likely, US will be able to comfortably come out of this problem also. At least that's what we learned from the Buffett AGM also. They don't bet against America in the long term.
So we saw that happening in 2008 when everybody said that this kind of liquidity printing will result in a very big dollar depreciation. But yeah, in fact, the reverse happened. The dollar strengthened against every other currency, right? Yeah. So maybe economics, the way it's taught in textbooks, may not translate into reality in the end. Right? Thank you, Naveen. Ramdev ji, a question for you, and these are 3-4 questions which have come with a similar. One is that there's a very big likelihood that, you know, the businesses in the past or the pre-corona world and the post-corona world will be very different. Okay? You'll have a lot of businesses doing extremely well as we go ahead, and a lot of businesses which may also have to shut shop or shut shutters because of the twin problem of A, the demand taking time to pick up, and B, the supply chain, I would say the supply chain misfunction which has been created. So people from a stock market perspective, investors ask that should we just sell right now and wait for it to recover? And secondly, how long do you think this entire premise will take to play out? Okay. And the third part, Ramdevji, is that what are the sectors then which will see a disproportionate kind of benefit in the post-corona world?
Ab ek ke baad ek puche.
So pehla ye Ramdevji ki, what is your feel that will some sectors come out very, very strong, some companies come out very, very strong in the post-corona world versus the pre-corona world?
Yeah, so abhi bhi aisa lagta hai ki, you know, world will be same. I mean, broadly, in 6 months, 8 months, of course, it will come a little hurt, like any other depression and all, like 2008 collapse happened and again, world came back. Of course, there was no disruption, but if you ask me, could you ever travel again back to US just, you know, buy a ticket and go? Today, that is not a situation right now. You don't have 50 flights to Delhi or, you know, tons of flights to London and New York. I think the world is actually disconnected right now, physically. You cannot go to most of the places. Even public transport in India itself is broken down. So, aisa bahut kuch badla bana jata hai. But अभी बिलीव ऐसा है कि यू नो विद अ गैप ऑफ 2-3 months, 4 months, 5 months, एवरीथिंग विल स्लोली कम बैक टू नॉर्मलिसी, बट येट इट विल हैव इट्स ओन स्कार, परमानेंट स्कार. सो द आई डोंट थिंक, यस ऑफ कोर्स इट विल गिव बर्थ टू सम बिजनेसेस. आई मीन वन बिजनेस विच क्लियरली लुक्स टू बी द न्यू किड इन द ब्लॉक, नॉट न्यू किड इन द ब्लॉक, बट यू नो विच हैज गॉट अ मेजर बूस्ट इज डिजिटाइजेशन ऑफ द वर्ल्ड इकोनॉमी. Digitization process was on for last 10-15 years. You know, every company is reporting what portion of their business is digital businesses, like Infosys, TCS. Somebody says it's 25%, somebody says 40%. And it all started just 5-7 years back. I mean, digital as a part of their entire IT business. So what I'm hearing is that that has got a major boost. And the guys are saying that nothing new is happening. Whatever was happening, the trend has become faster. So what could have happened in digitization in the next 3-5 years is happening in 3 months, 6 months. The corporates want the projects to be executed like tomorrow, you know. And one or two companies, they said that in April, they did the maximum business of booking the orders in IT. So that is a positive side of it, that yes, it can have. So there is a positive impact on digitization, bandwidth users, because everybody is sitting and sitting on Zoom. Kids are doing online. So the amount of bandwidth which are needed is crazy. And if you go on for 3-5 months, it will all become permanent, in the sense that the consumer behavior will change, the way we act will change. I'm finding Zoom to be so good that I'll definitely go to the office at 9 o'clock in the morning. But I will conduct a lot of meetings instead of the meeting room. I'll conduct from my table. You know, so those kind of changes will be there. But the changes which are going to be visible is between good company and bad company. Not so much about the businesses, but the companies which were pre-COVID also in the weak condition, financially weak condition, they will be pushed to the, you know, kind of a bankruptcy. And the companies which were on the verge of bankruptcy, I think mostly they will get wiped out. So from bucket one is good, bucket say 75% is good, 15% is like, say 70% is good, 30%, 15% is somewhere in between, and 15 is in any case suffering. So the last bucket, third bucket, I mean, so first bucket, some portion of 10-12% will go to second bucket, more than 50-60% of second bucket will go to third bucket, and third bucket 80-90% will just get wiped out. So I think that particularly in a prolonged situation, and if there is no very rapid, and I mean, that is what exactly world is trying to avoid in US and Europe, because businesses are, I mean, you can say that I will not help the airlines in US. What will happen? I mean, they've just shut the planes. There won't be any planes. So they're talking about single airline asking for $50 billion of bailout. I think Boeing itself has asked for
Boeing, yes.
$50 billion of single package. Mm-hmm. And they're looking at it, and probably they've given also. So I think, but then even central bankers or the finance ministers, they are God. They are bigger than God, actually, of this world. They will do everything, but yet I think a lot of scars will be there in terms of loss of demand, and hence it is very difficult to assess that final damage to the businesses right now. It is going to be extremely difficult. But I know one thing: the guys who are not conducting themselves well in terms of in a conservative way, or the guys who are already in trouble, they should be actually in the buying into smaller, badly managed companies, even at a very low prices, could be quite a dangerous call. And the guys, so what will happen is the market share will shift to the stronger guys. Big time market share shift will happen.
So Ramdev ji, does it make sense? So the simple investor, does it make sense that there's a lot of fogginess in the window right now? So should we sell all our holdings and wait for things to recover and then buy? Or would we have missed the train by then? Because clarity is always in hindsight. It's never in front of us.
Yeah, so this question keeps coming. See, one has to go by one's style. See, this is not the time to change the style. See, bottom mein samjh aata hai ki top kab hoga, top kaise dikhega, aur kyun aayega, kaise aayega, aur top mein samjh aata hai ki bottom kyun aayega. 3 mahine pehle US mein aisa hi lagta tha ki how this 11 year bull run will end. But in 11 days, the whole damn thing was wiped out. Who knew when Dow was at 31,000 that we are going to hit 20,000 in 11 days ahead?
Sure.
So that's the nature of this thing. So it is unpredictable. Markets are unpredictable, but goodness of the business are predictable. A good company will remain a good company. I mean, through the crisis, you might have seen actually very few companies pass through without any problem. Very few. And the companies see this is a multiple probability kind of situation. It's a probabilistic event. Who will win? Who will survive? Who will not survive? So, in businesses, every 7-8 years there is a business cycle, and this is also part of the business cycle, I would say, or say business uncertainty or challenge, and you have to survive every challenge. And challenge will come. I mean, sometimes it is financial, sometimes it is business, sometimes it is client, the business. So the guys who have survived through the ages because of their the way they conduct or the strength of the business model or cash flow or the value system, whatever. So you have, so that is what is going to work out. The guys who have survived through multiple setbacks in India in last 20 years, they are the best guys. They have the chance to survive in the future. So we don't know. Whether to sell now. At least I don't know. I have not practiced. My investment style is to remain fully invested and take on your chin the entire downside. Actually, I was in Calcutta in February, and somebody asked me in the live this thing that, sir, what do you think of the market? And so I was just talking about my three experiences of 92, 2000, 2008. Every time you go 10x and then you decline one third. So then it just crossed my mind that probably the chautha bulawa aa gaya. You know, so it crossed and I told the audience ki aisa lagta hai chautha bulawa aa gaya hai. So I'm mentally ready on my 2000 crores or 1800 crores portfolio to lose about 1000 crores optically. So it meant, so that is how I have worked. I have always tried to optimize my portfolio at every point of time. What a mistake is there, correct it and move on, remain fully invested. That's how I have been doing from 87. So you have to stick to your style, whatever works for you, and apni samajh se kaam karein. Kyunki meri samajh se aap nahi reh sakte, because if you remain fully invested and market goes down by say 10%, 20%, you will curse yourself. So you have to be psychologically also at comfort in what you do.
Ramji ji, one direct question: are you selling?
No, I'm fully invested. Okay. I'm fully invested. I don't have money for redemption. So what I'm saying is like 99.5% I'm invested. Just 0.5% is left for any redemption. In any case, mere paas personally to kuch paisa hai nahi. It's all in the fund. So some fund I must be having few percentage waiting for the next buy. They're buying, accumulating some stocks. So ek do taka hoga. But broadly, I'll be surprised if the entire AMC has more than 500 crores out of 32,000 crores.
Sir, Ramji ji, one last question for you. After this question to Naveen. Naveen, one question for you. Naveen, you're there?
Yeah. Yeah, he's there.
So, Naveen, with Indian government allowing extended moratorium on loan and deferring the IBC action and debt recovery, will this not affect public behavior towards repayment, which inevitably one has to do if he's borrowed money? Will this not affect public behavior in the end when this entire moratorium opens? And a general aversion towards banking or NBFCs is expected to have a massive negative impact on the money cycle, which may disrupt the economy going ahead. And if so, then how long this recovery may take?
So there is a lot of historical evidence that whenever there is a moratorium, the moratorium book, so let's say somebody has announced a 10% moratorium, like an HDFC bank. Some other banks have announced a 25 to 35% moratorium, like most other banks, right? So all these moratorium numbers are for April month, right? And then now in the month of May, I'm sure all of you are aware, the government has announced an extension of moratorium from 3 months to 6 months.
Yes.
So the moratorium will go on all the way till August. The first month of moratorium was March. Usually, very rarely, I mean, in fact, never in the history of India have you seen that customers accounting for 30-40% of your book, and that number may go up, did not pay for 3 to 6 months.
Okay.
What happens is that the day you then end the moratorium, will everybody then start paying from the next day?
That's a big question, yeah.
And if they don't start paying from the next day, then what will happen? Your books will start rolling forward. So I think these are very unprecedented times. All the industry wisdom of the past suggests that higher the moratorium, higher the NPLs, and higher the NPLs, higher the credit loss. So this is the fear right now, right? And second point is that the ability of our government to stimulate is less than the developed world. So whether it is United States or Japan or Europe, they have obviously got, you know, large ability to stimulate the economy. Given our rating and the fear of a potential rating downgrade to a non-investment grade country, you know, how much flexibility we can show to stimulate and grow our debt and debt to GDP and fiscal deficit is something which is a question mark. So the ability of the government to step in this situation is also limited. So given that scenario, I think that this remains a key risk for the lenders. Anybody with a leveraged balance sheet, which is leveraged 3 times, 6 times, 9 times, sometimes even more, and then you have problem in, let's say, 10-15% of your book, that is almost equal to or sometimes 2-3 times your net worth.
Yes.
Right. And so I think this is something which one will have to closely watch out for. And that's why, if you've seen, while financials have done very well, because even in the US financials have done very well in the last couple of days, but the overall fall of financials have been far more retrenching than the overall markets. And if you see, even today, after the bounce back, financials are still more, drawdown compared to any other sector or most other sectors.
Naveen, but isn't it largely this entire mortgage issue or the moratorium issue that the payments may not happen, the repayment culture will suffer? Isn't it largely priced into the stock prices currently? Okay, because you're having a, let's say, a large NBFC which was looking good at 8 times book. Okay, now you've corrected to 3 times book. Okay. So are we saying that the book itself is suspect, or the market is expressing its inability to predict what the book may look like after 1 year? So there are two parts to it. One is that is the market already having crashed the stocks to a 50% or 1/3 of the peak valuation? Is market smart in doing that? Because if the market was smart, then it wouldn't have given the 9x book value also. So market may not have been smart that time. Market may not be smart this time. So does it fundamentally, does it make sense to start cherry picking on the extremely high quality companies which have corrected significantly? Because if India has to grow and if India has to do well, then without a robust banking system and an aided NBFC sector, it's not going to happen, right? So should we bite? Should an investor start cherry picking and biting the bullet? If somebody's bought an Axis or some other stock at much higher price, it's okay. But should we start averaging or buy afresh, at least the extremely high quality names? Because HDFC Bank is a 20% compounder for the last 20 years. You are getting a chance to buy it at a 25% or 30% discount, which has never happened in the last 5 years, right? And if you take into the account the price that you buy right now, the 20% compound over the next 10 years, if HDFC Bank money can actually become a 25% compound. So should one seriously look at investing in these high quality names?
So the response to this is in 4 or 5 parts. Part number one is that forget financials, any high quality company which has longevity, if you buy it after it is down 25 or 50% like some of the banks are, you do very well over the long term, right? So that's the first answer, right? That buying any of these quality names now, and when you look at them 5 years later or 10 years later, the compounding should look very nice in my view. Second point is that all these financials can be divided into two parts today. One is NBFCs and the second is banks. Okay, NBFCs do not have the liability franchise that the banks have. And currently we have an abundance of liquidity for the banks. And if you see, for the first time in the history, again, banks' deposit rates have been brought down to below the repo rate. So now they're even earning on repo. They have 8.5 lakh crores parked there. And so they're earning a positive spread as per the incremental borrowing cost on that also, right? So banks are in a better position than NBFCs. So that is the second point, right? The third point is that once you've answered the question that any quality company after a big drawdown, longer term will give you returns, banks are better positioned than NBFCs. The third point is the short term, right? How will things do? So today afternoon, we were having a debate whether HDFC Bank will report a loss in the first quarter. Now, no analyst is estimating that, right? And we also don't know whether they'll do a loss. But the question is that they've reported a 9% moratorium as of March. And now will come June, when others have already reported a 25 to 35% moratorium.
Yes.
So and right now provisioning is based on moratorium number reported. It's a percentage of the moratorium book. And they're very conservative in their provisioning. Right? And 50% of their profit before tax comes from fee income. And fee income comes on disbursements. And that is evaporated. Correct? So we don't know But what we know is that if they do report a loss conservatively, like Axis did in the last quarter, and then you saw the sharp fall in the stock price, then in the short term, things could be challenging. So I think there is a disconnect. I mean, over the long term, I'm very sure that the likes of HDFC Bank and others will do very well. They will emerge from this crisis stronger. The value migration in their favor will continue. But in the short term, I'm not sure how the markets will respond as we quarter in the September quarter results.
Okay, thank you, Naveen. I think you explained it. Ramji, one final question for you. And this is a slightly patriotic question also. We've seen all this anti-China industry tirade across. Okay? And everybody is now very, very gung-ho that, you know, a lot of these factories will, because of this Chinese people perception that China has, you know, made the world into a big problem place. A lot of companies are seriously looking to move out of China. Okay? And whether they do or not is a question of the future, but at least that thought is there that a lot of countries like Japan or Europe are incentivizing industries to come back to their own homeland. How is India placed to attract these huge companies currently operating out of China? Can we really do it? Can we really pull it off? Ramji, mute aapka.
It is a good question. And I think first time aisa lag raha hai ki is it India's decade, you know? Today's Wall Street Journal is saying India is a natural US ally in the new Cold War, with US-China Cold War. So I went to see who's writing this. You know, I mean, anybody can say this, but who's the person in US, it matters who's writing this. And that to Wall Street Journal editorial. And this is Global View by Walter Russell Mead. He's some Yale professor on foreign affairs. So it looks that he's quite an authority on what he's writing. So I've not gone through the entire body of it, but the conclusion is that India is a huge natural ally for US for the propagation of democracy and prosperity of democracy in the years to come. And world has enough of China. And apart from their behavior and whatever virus and all. So you know, we forget when the world calls on India, you know, when Y2K happened, the problem was Y2K in 95-96. And they looked at India and with no power, no roads, no flights, no bandwidth, we delivered one of the most wonderful story in the world, from $1 billion to $150 billion of export today. The way world depends on China for manufacturing, the same way the world is dependent on India for software and pharmacy, you know, Sun Pharma and all that. So clearly we have our own brand of success stories at a global level and global scale. But for that to happen, a lot of things must come together. It's not only that we cannot keep finding our labor laws are bad, our land laws are bad. It was bad for at that time, even for software. It was not that easy to get a lot of things, Forex and things like that. So with a lot of difficulty, people then give the time has come for, I think Manmohan Singh said that time has come for India. I mean, it is the time for India. So that looks to be the situation right now. And it will be a geopolitically, you know, kind of extremely high decibel and big macro tilt the world can take in favor of India. So that also could be the possibility, because out of every crisis, I'll give you a small story. I was in MB Valley for last 30 days, 40 days, 50, sorry, 55 days. So one day I used to go to play golf. So there, I was learning that. So that mango tree was there and a lot of mangoes were there, but I was not able to pluck it because it was at the height. So there was a storm 5-6 days back. And in the morning when I went there, all the mangoes were lying on the ground. You know, so mango is, the storm is a big crisis. But yeah. What happened? I picked up 45-50 mangoes and took home and my wife made a pickle out of that. So what I'm seeing is that in this crisis, where are the mangoes? That we have to figure out. And I think it is very tough to figure out where mangoes will emerge, but it will emerge. I don't have any doubts about it. And it is India's time, I'm telling you. But how we play and how the world plays for India, we have done a lot of good things for the world. We have a very hot borders, China one side, Pakistan other side. But the oil has collapsed like nobody can believe. Forex balance is almost like a half a trillion. I mean, half a trillion forex balance itself gives you our food coffers are overflowing. Monsoon is fantastic. We have a very stable leadership. Let's look at the positive side of Modi being there. So, बहुत बहुत सारी चीज अच्छी हैं. Liquidity is ample. I mean, one of the worst thing of Modi government is that they starved the economy of the liquidity. I'm telling you, interest rate doesn't matter. You take another 1% up, but provide as much liquidity is required. So, I mean, a lot of positives are there. I can count. Whenever things open, when the uncertainty goes away, because we are permanent bull, so we can see a lot of positives. But I think you must play your cards very, and these are things which are not knowable. I'm telling you, don't waste your time. Keep reading, but very difficult to figure out. So I would remain a little, optimistic and cautiously optimistic, I would say. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ramdev ji. Thank you, Naveen, for extremely nice, invigorating, and instructive session. I really appreciate your inputs. And thank you all the participants for attending. We had some 700 at the peak. And it's a tribute to Warren Buffett. I hope he knows that we are having his session across the world here and trying to spread his belief. And thank you, everybody, for being. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.